Okay, now let's move on to the next principle of influence that I want to consider. It's the principle of commitment and consistency. One way I can significantly increase the likelihood that you will say yes to a request that I make of you is by first getting you to take a small step, a stand, that is logically consistent with that request I intend to make of you later. And that small step, that stand, has a name within social science. It's called your commitment, getting people to make a commitment. It's surprising how small that initial commitment can be and still lead to significant change in the future. Let me give you an example. From the restaurant, where there's a big problem that restaurant owners face. No-shows. People who call, book a table, and then don't appear to honor their reservation. They just don't show up. Everybody loses. Other people are turned away from the table. The restaurateur has gotten food and services and personnel ready, and there are empty tables. It's a big problem. So how do they solve it? Well, a couple of years ago, maybe you remember this, they tried a strategy that was a disaster. When you called to make your reservation, they would take your credit card number. And if you failed to appear for your table, they would dock your credit card $15 or $20. People hated that. There was such a revolution that most restaurant owners have abandoned that strategy. It just doesn't work. But there's a restaurant owner in Chicago named Gordon Sinclair who's figured out a way to do it by asking his receptionist to add two words to what she says when people make a reservation with her. In the past, she would say, "Thank you for calling Gordon's restaurant. If you have to change or cancel your reservation, please call." You've heard that many times, I'm sure. Now, she says, "Thank you for calling Gordon's restaurant. If you have to cancel or change your reservation, will you please call? Will you please call?" And then she pauses. "Well, tell me, what would you say if I said to you, 'If you have to change or cancel your reservation, would you please call us?'" "Well, most likely you'd say, 'Sure, of course, glad to.'" Well, now you have made an active, public, voluntary commitment. You've taken a stand. And no-shows at that restaurant since the change have dropped by 300%. Right? That small difference, two words. But those two words were powerful because they connected to a powerful principle of influence, something that governs our behavior. We want to be consistent with what we go on record as stating. Okay, what does that mean for you? Well, first of all, it suggests that there is something that we can do beyond simply creating change in others, because that's not really our goal, is it? We don't want just people to change. We want people to engage in lasting change. Change isn't enough if they're going to change right back after we leave, right? We want durable change, persisting change. Well, that's why certain features of commitments will cause people to live up to those commitments. And here are those features of a long-standing, persisting commitment. Commitments that reach into the future and cause people to be consistent with them are commitments that are first, active. Secondly, they are public. And thirdly, they are voluntary. Let's talk about each one. Active. It's not enough to let people leave a commitment in their heads, unstated. No, we need to get them to act on it, to behave in a way that's consistent with the commitment that we are asking them to take. And then they will become much more loyal to that commitment if they've acted on it rather than just privately agreed to what we're recommending. Secondly, public. People are even more likely to stay consistent with a commitment if it is visible to others. That commitment is public to those around that individual, right? And one way to get commitments that are both active and public, one of the most effective ways is to get people to write what they have agreed to, because people live up to what they write down. Even preliminary kinds of commitments, they're much more likely to stay loyal to them if those preliminary commitments are down on paper. So one of the things that we should always do if we're trying to, let's say, get a coworker to agree to a particular change in policy and practice in the office, it's not enough to get that person nodding his or her head and seeming to agree. No, you want that person to send you a memo that states what it is that you've both agreed to, and there it is in writing. Now, if it's a coworker who is not somebody who reports to you, but somebody who is equivalent to you in the organization or even a superior, you can't ask that person to send you a memo necessarily, but you can send that person an email saying, look, this is my understanding of what we decided. Is this what you understood as well? And if they say yes and reply to you, now there it is in black and white. There it is in writing again that this agreement has been made, and that will be much more powerful than allowing it to stay in somebody's head the way that we make New Year's resolutions that we keep in our heads privately and they're gone the next week. No, if they're down on paper, they're much more successful. Finally, the third component of lasting commitments is voluntary commitments. We shouldn't be trying to create commitments in people that don't naturally exist in them. We should be trying to locate existing commitments that people have, existing priorities and values, the things that they really want, they really value in the business setting in which we're dealing with them. And then we need to show them how what it is we are recommending is logically consistent with the value, the commitment, the internal priority that they already have. That requires no twisting of the arm, no deception, no coercion, and we can leave the situation and people will still want to be consistent with what we've recommended because what we've recommended is consistent with what they carry around inside them. In this way, our job is to spend enough time to get to know the people we're dealing with and identify their true values and then show them how what it is that we are offering is congruent with their values. People don't resist their own values. So our job as a detective of influence is to uncover those values and then to demonstrate the connection between what people are already committed to and what it is that we have to offer.